Good afternoon. Calling to order this Board of Select meeting for the town of Deerfield, February 5th, 2016 at, I don't know what time it is.
3:40 p.m.
3:40 p.m. Meeting being held at 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass. First thing on the agenda is reviewing minutes. I assume you don't have the minutes with you, Mark?
No, I don't.
So let's pass on that.
Good enough.
Next thing on the agenda is accept the 2015 landfill annual post closure report.
The board received an 8-page post closure report at a meeting at least a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago, if not the meeting before that. But a vote was never formally taken. So this is just a bit of business to just to close that out. That allows the post-closure report to be submitted to the DEP. So we just need a formal vote of the board.
Mark, do you remember what it was?
Not off the top of my head, but it rings a bell. It was something where we talked about the engineering's report, if my memory is correct.
That's correct. This is the annual report that's completed by Weston and Sampson. It's basically a summary of all the monitoring and engineering activities that were done up there at the landfill site. And it allows us to continue to not have to pay fines or fees or anything like that. So
I think that you should accept it. I'll make a motion to accept the report as presented.
And I'll second that.
Any further discussion?
The only further question, suggestion I have is that we actually go back and look at are we hitting the mark? Are we getting the best out of what we're doing? Are we doing things that we don't need to do just because we always have? So just do a review of it at some point. Have Kevin take a look at it and see if it's, we've got a bunch of zeros where it doesn't matter, and see if there's something we can do to minimize the amount of money we're paying and sampling and testing. We did it once before and it dropped, and I think our numbers are good, so that we should be looking at, is there anything else we can be dropping?
Right. When we switched to Weston and Sampson, we were able to drop some of those wells. You know, yeah. I mean, they weren't even.
So I think it's a good question to ask of them again now that they've summarized the report. Yeah. There's something else that we should be changing or minimizing or in the worst case scenario, there's something else we should be ahead of the curve with, because I hate paying fines and things because we're not doing the things that are indicated. But I think this, we can be doing less rather than more.
Okay.
I'll do that. I'll follow up with Kevin.
I think Kevin had a plan.
But that's my only question. My only observation, I think we should go ahead and accept it as written.
Yeah. Any further? Uh-huh. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. 300.
Thank you.
Okay, next thing is a fiscal year 2017 budget.
Hold that thought and I will go and get it.
You know, one of the things about the budget, Mark and Carolyn, that's, I guess, the hot topic is wages and salaries. Mm-hmm. And what we're going to do with them for this upcoming year. Are we going to wait for the compensation study to make a definitive, or should we put something preliminary in, or have the department heads put something preliminary into the budgets?
You want this instead? Oh.
I think we've done this in the past, but we haven't done a good job of explaining what we're doing. Because we put a number out there, preliminary, just to make sure that we can make the budget work. And everybody thinks that's possible, and they get all upset, and they get thrown out of shape about it. So I'm in favor of putting a number out. It doesn't matter whether we say zero growth or 3% or whatever, because somebody's going to find issue with it. So whatever we do, we should...
Yeah.
Put a stake in the ground so we can start planning as to what we're going to be doing with the rest of the budget.
Okay. Just be advised that Bill Cummings and Jeff Upton are sitting in the meeting with us, Mark. So
I understand that.
If you want to ask them something on the finance side, that's...
I wasn't aware, wasn't sure
yeah, if you knew they were here or not.
Yeah, the thing about it is we haven't, at this point in time, nailed the budget. Doug's done a good job of trying to keep it in control.
Yeah.
But I think the reality is that we're going to have some hard conversations at this point. Doug has a recommendation for a number to put in there. Just as preliminary to make the budget work out, I don't have a problem with that. But again, we haven't done any of the hard work yet. They've done all their work in getting us what they think they need. We now have to figure out how to make it fit in the financial framework of the town.
This is Doug. Are you talking just about salaries, or are we talking about the budget as a whole?
Are we talking about salaries or just the budget?
Doug, can you repeat what you just said?
I'm sorry. I asked if you were just referring to salaries or salary line items or the budget as a whole in terms of providing a broader review.
Dave's question was about salaries
okay.
and what we were going to do for our planning process.
Okay.
I was talking just about salaries because it sounds the departments have their budgets already lined out for us for the most part, at least by left they did. And we're going to do some finish, Doug, you were going to do some finishing up of that tweaking, and then we should be looking at numbers at this point and make a writing at that at that juncture. In the past years, we've failed miserably of trying to make people understand why we put our budgets for personnel costs where they are. And this is the last year before we do the police budgets and can get it into line where we don't have a us and them debate. My gut feeling right now is that we should be treating it all as the same number, but let the town side of it, not the police side of it, move the money around in departments to honor or reward the people that are actually doing the work that should be performed within their budget. And that's a hard decision for the department heads to use and to do. But I think that's where we really need to be leaning in this next negotiation for the police and just start getting it back to a merit-based thought process that we've always tried to get it into, rather than we're doing it because somebody else screwed up somewhere.
Yeah.
Right.
Am I making any sense, or is this...
Yeah. Yep. I'm following you.
So. Doug, there's no mosquito control money in here.
Okay. That might have been an oversight.
And there...
I can't speak to any of the other stuff as to, you know, the overall department's budgets, because basically I haven't looked at where they were last year and why they're going up.
Okay.
Sure. And why they've changed.
And does John still have the resource officer in his budget?
John does still have it in his budget, yes.
Because last year, for the resource officer, didn't we make the decision that that would be only existent if we had outside funding for it? That's a school resource?
Right. That the basis was the resource fund. Yeah, he could only fund it with money not out of his budget. It's going to be in his budget, but basically we had to have revenue to cover it. Basically, it looks like we have that money there. I'm not sure that we can cover that he can cover the benefits portion of it.
Right.
But I think that he can cover the extra salary portion of it. And if he's not putting on a ninth person with benefit, then it probably meets the intent of what we thought we were going to do. But again, I haven't seen the actual checks come in. I know that in conversation that the money should be there.
My understanding is that right now there is $30,000 in a public safety account, with the understanding that that money would be used towards a school resource officer, that was gifted from Deerfield Academy, but that doesn't even fully fund the salary for that position.
No, but my understanding is that there was going to be some discussion with the schools to put money, the Frontier and some other schools to put money in the budget for that resource officer.
Okay.
So there should be a line item in their budgets to cover that. I'm sure John will correct me if I'm wrong, but that's my understanding was part of it was going to be private, part of it was going to come from the school budgets.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll look into that. Because we have both Frontier's and elementary school budgets, right?
I have not seen Frontier's preliminary budget, no.
Okay, I saw a number in here, so I didn't.
That number is a very rough estimate. Yes. That number is an estimate based on an average of increases over the past 5 years, essentially. But we don't have a preliminary number from Frontier. We do have a preliminary number from Deerfield Elementary, but it's only from their draft budget. It hasn't been finalized or voted on by the school committee.
And they're in the midst of
collective bargaining, correct.
Right, so they can't put a real number in. It could be less, it could be more. they just wanted a placeholder in there to get what they think they were going to, in the ballpark of where it was going to be.
They also have to wait for the enrollment for the kindergarten as well?
That's one of the bigger things, and that should already be in. That should have been in last Monday or Tuesday.
Okay.
It is?
I don't know.
I know they're talking between two and three.
I wasn't aware that it was in yet, so.
Numbers.
It looked like it was pretty solid at 35 or less, and that means that you wouldn't start another class.
Okay.
Okay. Why don't I pick it up right here? The narrative that I put together at the beginning talks a little bit about a few things. I'm going to strongly encourage, and I'm hoping that the Board of Selectmen will support moving any free cash, or as much free cash as we can at the end of the year, into a capital stabilization account. This does several things. One, it allows us to begin to put aside money for longer-term capital projects. Two, it prevents money from simply drifting over into next year's free cash, which puts it into a black hole between July 1 and, say, mid-September anyways. Whereas if we put it into a stabilization fund, we could use it right away if we need to. Three, it does require a two-thirds vote of town meeting to pull from that stabilization account, but that also keeps the appropriation authority with town meeting where it should belong. But finally, it's a step that basically tells the town that we're trying to save for these long-term expenses and provide an easier way to pay for the high-dollar items instead of having to hit all at once based on need every single high-dollar item that comes down the line. I do think it'll provide greater flexibility in the town for meeting capital expenses without causing a lot of pain in the short term. So I'm hoping that the Board of Selectmen would support that.
I'm in agreement as well.
Yeah.
Pardon?
We have underinvested for many years, so I am...
Oh, yeah.
I'm absolutely...
And, to be honest with you, I think that we shouldn't be afraid to... consider the stabilization that part of the free cash number if we have to. In other words, even if we, they're looking at a 5% number for free cash, and if we come up with, $800,000, I think that we should make the motion and support putting half of that into stabilization and half into, leave half in stabilization and put half into a capital. Stabilization fund, so that basically you're splitting it. If you can't get 5% in both of them split whatever it is. But I wouldn't recommend going below $400,000 in free cash.
Okay. My numbers right now work out to providing a grand total of about $460,000 or $480,000 in free cash when all is said and done. That's what it's looking like we're going to have left. Not discounting any thoughts about setting aside money for a 5% cushion or anything like that. This budget is very heavy. This budget is heavy on insurance costs. It's heavy on increases in insurance mostly. And the schools are also, of course, increasing their budgets. There are increases in staffing in a couple or three departments that I have concerns about. But this budget is heavy. And as a result, even though we're looking at a $1.4 million balance in free cash right now, I'm looking at, as far as I can tell, this budget would use about $950,000 of that. So,
is that taking consideration $10,000?
And I guess it's our job to see if we can take and put,
you need to put that back in.
Some of that money, that $900,000 that we're taking out of free cash, get it back out of the budget somewhere and put it back into the stabilization fund. So that's the work that's ahead of us right now. Because my goal was to have, you know, we should out of $1.4 million be able to come up with at least $300,000 or $400,000 in stabilization and $400,000 in free cash. We're trying anyways.
Okay.
I don't hear anybody else saying anything.
Yeah. Well,
is anybody nodding or are they all sticking their tongue out at me?
No, it's just, you know.
Can we do that? Mm. I think we're on camera here. I don't suppose we can.
Okay.
It's just that you're going to start cutting people, Mark. You know. The insurance that Doug is talking about is related to cost of drugs. I mean, we've had zero increases on, you know, Hampshire Trust. Hampshire Trust has done a really good job. We just need to encourage our employees to go to the Canadian drug supply. There's a website, you can order the drugs from Canada, and they will get, and it will cut our drug costs in half. The entire increase is related to pharmaceutical drugs going up. And that's the exact same thing that happened to the FERCOG. You know, they're
yeah,
expensive.
I'm aware that there are things we can't overcome and we may not be able to hit that target, but if we don't try, then shame on us for at least not trying.
Yeah.
I know.
I'm not saying we're going to hit it. I'm not saying that that's what I'm going to stand ground on. I think that we need to look at it and just see what we can do.
Well, what we have to do is have Doug send out a memo, get the information from Lynn Sibley is the one that at the FERCOG did the informational to all of us that were there at the council meeting about being able to purchase drugs through the Canadian website. And if we encourage everyone to do that, then we should be able to cut the expenses for next year. And apparently it's legal, so. It just entails a little bit of extra work for people. But if people knew that the entire increase is related to just pharmaceuticals increases because they can, then they should get mad and to say, I will go to the Canadian website, you know, because this means a person. This is a person plus benefits somewhere.
It's what it means.
Yep.
I mean, it's gross. It's disgusting. You know, it makes me so mad.
Anyway. So insurance is an issue.
Absolutely.
And I've got a meeting with Mick Gerald from Maya, who's going to walk me through next week. He's going to walk me through our entire insurance portfolio, everything from health insurance and general insurance, general liability, all the way down the line. And hopefully, by the end of that, I'll have a better understanding as to where we're spending money and why and how. If there's any opportunity for pulling some of that insurance cost out of non-exclusively tax money, then I will make those recommendations if we can. I'm not hopeful, but I will do what I can. We'll try.
Thank you very much.
There were a number of other increases that are in here. I do want to point out a couple, and before I do, I want to say that I'm not doing this out of spite. I'm not doing this to get anybody upset, and I'm certainly not doing this out of malice or anger towards anybody. I'm just simply pointing out concerns, pointing out issues. Of course, we already talked about the police department. There's the additional position of school resource officer that added $40,000 to that budget. If we're going to choose to not fund that, that's great. That'll cut $40,000 plus out of that payroll budget. I have also to have a conversation with John Pachorek, the chief, about the Quinn bill. The state ruled in 2012 that towns were no longer responsible for paying the state portion of the Quinn bill, not paying the state's portion. I don't think that'll be a whole lot. It might be $20,000 or $30,000 off the police budget, maybe less, but I think that's worth taking a look at. Police department expense went up a grand total of $1,800, so I'm not going to touch that one. That's just fine. Looking at its inspection salaries, two significant changes happened with the inspections and the health agent budgets. One is that the inspector, building inspector, went from, I think, three-quarter time to full time, which represents a significant jump of over $20,000 a year. We also added about a day worth of time to the health agent position and increased the salary to match the inspector's, the building commissioner's salary. Those two changes represent about $30,000 on the upside.
Dick is getting, what's that, Scott? What's his first name?
Kyle Scott.
Kyle has more hours because Dick has more work, and Valerie from Foothills in Waitley is covering some of Dick's time too.
Right.
Because there's just so much work. Again, there's nothing we can do. I mean, Dick is bringing in almost $1 million worth of inspection permits, so. I mean, the work is there and it's covered.
Is the expectation that he is going to be hiring someone else or adding significant hours?
He may have to.
Because he's still listed as both the building commissioner and the health agent, and he's listed as working 7 days a week.
Wow.
Between the two salaries. So
the salaries for him is Valerie and Kyle. It's under him, but it's not. He's not working any more than he is. He actually is cutting back on his hours.
So we're actually going to add hours to Kyle and Valerie's time?
Yes.
So we actually should move the money from the commissioner's line item to the inspector of buildings and inspector of health, respectively?
Yes. You just have to figure out. I mean, you'll have to talk to Dick.
Okay.
How many hours? I know Valerie's going to be doing some of the inspections because Dick can't keep up.
But all of that's not going to be added until income is being...
Oh yeah.
Right. Well, the other thing,
it shouldn't inflect the increase, because basically we have revenue in to cover revenue out.
Well,
yeah.
That's true.
It shouldn't hurt us.
One of the things that we are doing, and it's actually not in the budget sheets that I've got handed out here, is that our revenues, our local receipts, will be increasing by roughly $65,000, because the recommendation, and I've talked with Brenda about this, and she's checked with the folks at the state level about this, and it seems to be the best possible plan, is to actually take the plumbing, gas, and wiring revolving account and basically just deauthorize it. Which means that revenues from plumbing, gas, and wiring permits will simply go into the general budget, and we can show that as revenue. This is why on the inspections budget, for the first time ever, you're seeing the plumbing, the gas, the wiring inspectors, And on the inspections expense, you're seeing expenses for those positions. Just a $1,000 line item for each one of those positions. So yes, absolutely, we're going to see additional revenue, but we're also seeing the additional expense here as a result.
Right, it's kind of, you know, wash. It shouldn't show as much of an issue for the bottom line.
Right.
The thing it's going to do, though, is show us where the bottom line is being hurt, because we should be taking all that revenue out, revenue in, and it should just be a simple balance line. And when we get to the point where we're not bringing in as much money as we're paying out, we need to really think about adjusting hours down to be reflective of money coming in.
Right, right.
Well, it would be automatic.
That department should be functional, as you know. It should be self-supporting for all intents and purposes. There's going to be a few years. It's going to be a little bit less, but those same years there should also be years where it's high. We got more coming in than actually we're spending.
Yeah.
That just balances itself over a 5-year period. The things we don't want to do is have a lot of revenue and no money out. You know, we're not really doing the inspections that we're getting paid for, or vice versa. So that one there doesn't scare me as much. I think that's pretty much going to be a balance or a wash.
Sure.
If not, then the way we're accounting for it now should show us that it's not effective.
Okay. So we are, I do expect in the end, after FY17 is closed out, you know, a year from next summer, I do expect that we'll see a better bottom line. We'll see a larger free cash number as a result. But Brenda's recommendations are to be conservative on the receipts, the local receipts that might come from these inspections. So in the short term, it looks just like a wash. It looks like barely just, you know, same in, same out. But in the long term, we may see a benefit from that.
Right. And the problem is that after a boom year, a light year like the 2008, we had more money going out than we had coming in.
Sure.
Like considerably more. But we can't do that for multiple years. That's just not prudent to do.
Deerfield Academy was still pulling permits, paying for permits.
Yeah.
They still kept us. That's why we have free cash that is so high. Because we don't really. Whatever. We can show that the income is quite considerable. And that we have to.
Well, we can show that, but we don't want to overspend. We don't want to overpay or over budget or spend money that we're only not using in this.
Yeah, no, but Mark, we won't.
That's another whole conversation. I think that we're getting to the point where we can understand it in the next couple of years, but right now, it's not going to change anything. We're going to have money in, money out.
Right.
And that's not something, you know, Dick's gearing up for something that's going to happen. Are we really paying the same amount for our inspectors as we're paying for Dick?
Almost.
How come? Dick should be certified well beyond or above what these people are doing. Why are we paying so much for inspections?
Well, because when we have
somebody that's a commissioner that should be paid at a much higher rate, I think
he's within the
scope of what
but
he should
Mark,
be paid.
We're not
but
paying
Mark,
benefits to them.
Well, you don't pay benefits to them, and they have to go drive somewhere, and they have to, and it's like, you know, they look at whatever it is, so we pay them $35 an hour. Which is more than we pay Dick.
For information's sake, the salaries line item shows 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 separate positions. All of the plumbing, gas, wiring, building, and health inspectors positions. Those five separate positions represent slightly less than the salary being paid to the building commissioner, the one building commissioner. So collectively, we're paying five people about the same amount that we're paying the one building commissioner. I don't know if that answers your question.
Does that make sense to anybody?
Well, you're asking people to come in for a couple of hours at a time, so you have to pay them. Otherwise, otherwise they aren't going to do it. That's why if you pay them $35 an hour, This is what you pay the wiring, plumbing, and gas. Remember, we went through this, Mark. We went and we did the whole salary. We went out and we did the salary kind of comparisons. And this is what inspectors, we picked the medium right in the middle. This is what inspectors are making.
As so are the permit fees covering the $35
out? That's the expectation.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. So that's why we have so much extra cash.
Yeah. No. You're trying to mix the big picture with the little one. We have individuals that we come in to have support the building commissioner. Each one of those inspections should we pay a fee for that. A plumbing inspector or whatever.
Correct.
Basically, those inspections in an individual case, are they being covered?
Yes.
That's the big picture, because we get a lot of money for permits that aren't inspectors. Those are just permits to do the job.
Right.
But we also charge out a fee for the inspection itself. As long as it's covered, the $35 is covered by the fee that we're asking for, and it's in line with best practices, I won't have an issue. But
yes, very much so. This year,
we actually lowered some of the fees because we were charging one of the highest fees.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it is still paying for the time. Yes. That revolving fund, the plumbing, gas, and wiring revolving fund right now has about closer to $80,000 in it. And that represents monies that came in that were never expended from that fund. So we're paying for people plus.
Remember, we switched to everybody doing it, paying the town, and we switched.
Yes.
And this is
generally. So that increase in the budget is not, it's funded. There's no big deal.
It's funded by fees.
My concern is more about who's actually doing what work and what rate are we paying them. That's all.
Well, I think we need to make sure we stay in line. And as Carolyn said, we don't want to overcharge more. For an inspection, we don't want to undercharge, and we don't want to overpay for something that is customarily done more reasonably throughout Franklin County or South County or whatever we want to use for the basis of our decision making.
Yep.
Because we need to defend ourselves.
Yep. Okay. Moving forward on these, as we mentioned earlier, the Deerfield Elementary School budget is draft. It's only preliminary at this point. It shows a 3.6% increase to 4.5 million and change. But as with all the other departments, the salary budgets, I've included also a benefits budget sheet. The benefits budget sheets do not get added into the bottom line. They're there for information only. But for Deerfield Elementary, our roughest estimates for benefits for the employees in that department is about $700,000. So that $4.5 million budget really is 5.2 when you come down to it. Again, just for information only, we don't have any real way to... Well, my understanding is the position of the school department is that we don't assess them for health insurance costs, and we can't assess them for health insurance costs.
We can't assess them, but we can put it out publicly that basically with the increases that all the town employees and everything else has, their true balance, their true budget number is 5.2% increase, which is not sustainable.
Sure.
That's a talking point that we should be pushing out and make sure that Patty and all of them understand that basically the increase that they've gotten has been sheltered by all this, and because we gave them great rates for 3 years of no interest or no insurance benefit cost, that they're not exempt from this thought process. And basically, their budget is going up by 5.2 or whatever our number is.
Sure.
And that they have to be aware that this is what's costing the townspeople for the services that they're doing. And it's servicing less children from the town. So it's a great talking point. We can't assess them, but we are really assessing the townspeople that. We don't do that.
Yeah.
The townspeople have to pay it. Mm-hmm. And we just make sure that the townspeople know that the budget has gone up by 5.2%, which is double what Proposition 2.5 allows.
Sure.
Yep.
Sure.
So I would send a nice little letter to them saying, hey, in calculating the cost of the school, these are the real numbers based upon these reasons, and just send it to them for their information in a memo form so it becomes formally documented that that's what cost is.
Okay.
And we would appreciate anything they could do to help reduce that cost so that the taxpayers don't have to absorb it.
Okay. Is that a suggestion?
That would be my recommendation.
$1,000 if that's not accounted for.
So, and then when you're looking at the cost of the benefits increasing as much as they are this year, because the insurance is going up, it even has a larger ripple effect.
Right. And the thing about it is, we ourselves should be prepared to take a same look at all of our departments with real time. How much they cost for benefits increases.
And that's
boil it down to percentages, and be prepared to discuss why we allow them to be higher than the 2% or less than the 2%, and in real time. So it's not to them. It's we're all in this game together. We all go to the same rules. We go to the same thought process, and let the taxpayers decide whether or not this.
Yeah, well, Doug has done a good job. He's done a good job of. Attaching a benefit summary for each department.
Right.
That's the best starting point. That's great.
Yep. And it's in here again. It's not just the school. It's all departments. So we're not just
isolated. We have to do that, or they won't listen to us.
Right.
Right. Right.
Exactly.
So the next budget I was going to point out is Highway Department salaries, which represents a 1.6% increase over last year. Very, very modest. General highway expense, and actually a number of the other budgets under Kevin's control that relate to materials or supplies, these are seeing significant increases. But I wanted to point out that those are based on straight need. Many of his budgets were cut artificially right near the end of the budget process last year, where we were trying to find $10,000 here, $20,000 there, anywhere we could. And both Kevin and the chief, John Pachorek, actually put in cuts to their budgets, which the chief was a little more comfortable with, Kevin was far less comfortable with. And even at the time last year, he basically said, well, I'll cut the budget, but I'm going to be coming back for a transfer later on in the next fiscal year, because even at that time, he knew that the budget was being cut too severely.
We realized that. We didn't have a good handle to go on.
Right.
But the one thing I want to make sure that we go back and make sure we're comparing apples to apples is the fact that the budgets themselves, even with like the highway employee budget, I want to go by what we actually spent.
I totally understand.
And what not what we budgeted last year.
I totally get that.
What did we really spend? And I want to do that for everything. So if we, then I'm going to pick salt, which doesn't matter. If we said we're going to budget this amount for salt and we spent considerably less because we didn't have any bad weather, we have a reason to say, hey, this is all we spent. But if we go back 5 years, we spent this amount, and this is a good number to put in that place. We know that it's going to be artificially low. We've got to keep it up where it's at. And then on the reverse of that, this is how much we spent in labor costs or whatever. And we spent less because we didn't have all our positions filled.
Sure.
But we spent more or whatever. But I want it based upon what we spent.
Okay. And I understand that. I've also got from Brenda a list of expended from FY 11 through 14. That's included in these budget sheets. I'm also looking at how much has been expended so far this year, and the up-to-date numbers for last year, how much was expended in each department. I'm comparing the as expended from FY 15 to the request for FY 17, taking an FY 16 into account. I've only gotten through some of the departments. For the most part, everybody seems to be right online. The one I know that I've already recognized that it's in the salaries for the highway department where there was a significant difference. The request was $413,000. The expended was $384,000. But that's because the highway department was running one man short. And I expect that that will carry over a little bit into FY16 because we only just hired K3 four months ago, whatever. So the as expended for 2016 is also going to seem shy of what was budgeted for salaries. Sorry, go ahead.
And on the snow and ice market, and Carolyn, if I'm correct,
we can't go
lower because then we can't deficit spend, right?
Correct.
Right. This is an average that we picked.
Yeah.
Last year,
okay.
It blew out.
Yeah, right.
This year, hopefully, we'll be under.
Right now, we're about 30. Well, prior to today, we were at about $30,000, $35,000. And is that right? Right around $35,000 for the year. Today, we'll change that, I'm sure.
But it's still under.
Well under the 83, absolutely.
Yeah.
And when I asked Kevin about increasing that budget, he said, no, leave it at 83. We can legally overspend, and 83 is just fine. So,
okay.
There's that. Yeah, but, you know, we can't legally overspend.
I apologize.
We have in our bottom line budget, but we can move things around as we've done in the past to cover the gaps, which means our free cash is going to pay the price for whatever we move around.
Sure.
Because it doesn't go into free cash afterwards.
Sure.
But we really have to start being real with our numbers because whether the school plays ball with us or not, we're looking at a non-sustainable budget.
Yeah.
That's a rock-hard bottom of this thing. We're not in a position without going to a Proposition 2.5 in the next couple of 3 or 4 years of sustaining what we're doing. And if we want to keep a sustainable budget in place, we have to find those things that either we've been doing that we don't have to do, or do what we want to do better so that it doesn't cost us as much money.
Sure.
Yeah.
You know, we've worked around this Proposition 2.5, and, you know, Deerfield Academy has bailed us out a couple of years in a row. At one point in time, that's gravy train is going to go away. And it's kind of, Carolyn will attest it. We sent money out of the ranks many times to cover the things that needed to be done. And with good narratives and good discussion, it's easy to make the decisions. You don't have to think a lot about it. But we have to have the good thought and keep impressing on people's mind that we're looking for ways that we can make our people work smarter, not...
Yeah,
sure.
Not higher and more expensive.
Okay.
Jumping forward a few, if I may. The transfer station budget, I think that the two of you have, it actually doesn't match the one that I have. One of the things that I did, and I checked with Brenda to determine how we could do this, but I'd like to pull the test well and the post-closure landfill monitoring out of the transfer station budget and create an entirely separate budget sheet just for that. I think I've done that, and Carolyn and David are both looking at that. And the reason I'm suggesting that is because if you remove those two expenses from the transfer station budget, what you have is a budget that is only slightly higher than the revenues we get for operating the transfer station. This is something we talked about last year, but we didn't pull the test well monitoring out of the transfer station budget to do this. Checking with Brenda, she determined a way we could do this beginning in FY17. So I've split out those costs. This is a rough approximation. I want to confirm the numbers with Brenda, but they're pretty close. So it brings our transfer station expense down to just about $200,000. Transfer station roughly accounts for about $165,000 in revenue over the course of the year. Essentially, we're paying for the staff. We're paying for the staff hours, and that's it. Everything else is paying for itself. I asked Kevin if he thought about increases in fees for transfer station, and he shook his head, absolutely not this year. We did a pretty big increase last year, and he would be afraid of civil rebellion if he did another increase 1 year, you know, a year later. So,
yeah.
But
well, we've been narrowing the gap. I mean, at one time we had a $150,000 deficit.
Sure, sure.
I mean,
I don't think that any of the stuff that's with the transfer station is frivolous in its realm.
Right.
Trying to talk about cutting it or changing it or showing a better picture of it is just, for me, eye candy. I don't mind however you want to do it.
Okay. Yep. I'm trying to present this information in a clear enough way so that everybody understands that. Let's say someone said, close the transfer station, save money. Well, you'd save about $35,000, but that's it.
And then you'd be picking up trash.
And you'd be picking up trash everywhere. So you'd actually wind up with an expense greater than that $35,000. Right. So
yes. There's
that.
That even with the bulky item dumpster not being available, that ended up having to
spend hang on for a second.
They had to spend money to collect, you know, stuff that was dumped.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're adding $10,000. Sure. Jumping forward to Board of Health of expense, we're adding $10,000 for mosquito control district.
Yes. Well, it's not the district; it's an MOU, and it's under the MOU. It's that proposal.
Have we signed that?
No, because I don't want to make a commitment until we have the money.
Right.
We don't have the money.
Okay.
But it's to work. It's with a commitment with Greenfield to have someone do monitoring. And the mosquitoes, and then spraying.
Okay. We'll put that in there.
No grants or anything that covers?
No. We've been trying to work through the state, and the state...
Even with the new Zika?
Yeah, well, I was on a CDC call, and also, you know, we've been talking about statewide, but...
Carolyn, you keep fading in and out.
I'm sorry.
I understand you. If I understand you correctly, just simply that we're adding $10,000 for a mosquito control
right.
initiative.
We have...
I would recommend that we put that as an article and not put it in the budget, because it's so much harder to get it out of the budget after we put it in place, because we just keep moving it around.
Well, Mark, the reason why I don't want it to be an article is because this will be a reoccurring expense. What we're doing, is committing to go with Greenfield. It's about $39,000 if you looked at that proposal to do this alone. And by working with Greenfield, the people will come out from the eastern part of the state. They'll monitor our mosquitoes and they'll do some spraying. And we have to do something. We got West Nile disease and we have triple E. There's no question. Random sampling last year by the state out here showed that there was West Nile in town. So this is way before the Zika stuff came out. All the discussion of the Zika stuff at this point is that the mosquitoes aren't going to come any, you know, more north than Connecticut. But, I mean, who knows? There's already
the storm wasn't either.
I know. Well, there's already one case in Massachusetts, and it, you know, they don't know how it's passing or whatever. So the thing is, we need to get something started. We're trying to work up and down the Pioneer Valley, and
Carolyn, I agree with doing it. I agree with trying to get something going, but it's all experimental. You don't put something in the budget for something that may not occur again or may change dramatically. Well,
I disagree. This is a commitment. This is a long-term commitment we're trying to do. We are giving up on the mosquito control district, which is fine with me because the money comes off the cherry sheet and we have less control because the state's involved. This is a long-term MOU with other towns up and down the valley, and what we're trying to do is have someone come out and work with us so that there's just not a single town. The mosquitoes don't stop at the border. This is, we're trying to get something going, and this is a long-term commitment. We've been meeting for 2 years trying to get this going. We've been going to Boston, talking to people, trying to get this going. And so we're just working ourselves. The towns are working together, and we're doing this. And it's a long-term commitment. This is a long-term expense. This is not something experimental. This is not, you know, this is only going to work if everybody does it. And we work together, and we are vigilant. And so it's not a one-shot deal.
It should be something that's set specifically its own attention grabber, so that basically people know that we're doing something, and it just doesn't get buried in the operating budget at this point in time. You can call it non-experimental because you've been looking at it for 3 years or whatever. I think this is a way that we tell the people what we're doing about mosquito stuff and make sure that it's...
We have a line item.
Mark,
we have a line item for mosquitoes in the budget. That's why we're only adding 10,000. We have 1,200 already. But throwing discs out don't work.
Okay, not enough. Okay, do what you want to do.
I
disagree with you. And my reason for disagreeing is not even being discussed. What you're talking about is you want it funded. I think this funding stream needs to be more public. You disagree. Okay, just let it go. Next item, Doug.
Okay.
Well, Dave hasn't weighed in on it.
Well, I'd like...
Sorry.
No, that's right. It's, you know, I'd like to see, you know, if FERCOG or HCOG, you know, with everything that's happening, both these organizations should be looking at mosquito control, and they should be looking at grants and things and seeing if they could subsidize some of this instead of it. You know, I understand the cooperative with the town of Greenfield, but it's just...
Well, there's no money out there.
Yeah.
Nobody's giving out anything. So either we do it or we don't.
Mm.
And it should be, it's going to be a reoccurring expense. And that's why I don't want it to be separate. And we've been buying discs, but discs don't work. And people expected us to do more. And we have been making the effort to try to do more, but it's just not working. We have to go to the next level. And the reason why I would like to see this as an MOU is because if it doesn't work, then we just drop it down. It's no big deal. If it's a line item, we have the ability to control it, and we got to do something else if it's not working. Clearly, if the Zika threat is more and it gets more expanded, then yes, there'll be money, some federal money. But I can tell you right now, for the state of Massachusetts, there is nothing. And this is way before the Zika. This West Nile is here, and Triple E is here, and that's why we have got to do something. This has nothing to do with the Zika thing. That's just on top of it.
I'm just my contention is the Zika is right on the verge of exploding into a lot of things, because just within the last two days, I've read articles where it's now sexually transmitted.
Yes, and that's why
So that's putting you in a whole different spectrum of things. So
right,
I can't believe that there's not going to be federal or state money for that.
Oh, Dave, and I agree. And we will look for everything, and everybody will be out looking. But this is a proposal that we have. It's really important that we've worked and massaged this down from so much money.
Can we get a copy of the MOU to take a look at?
Oh, we haven't even got the MOU. I mean, this is all we have is a proposal that's based on multiple towns. And the MOU, if people will budget it, then we will go forward with the MOU, okay? The MOU is just saying that we're going to work together, and that our health departments are going to cooperate and all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
So this is just to have the funding in there, and then
then
the guy is going to come and we'll talk about it and all kinds of stuff. But there's no sense in having them come out from the eastern part of the state and talk about things if there's nobody can come up with any money.
Yeah.
And
let me, if I can, think about it and get back to you.
All right. Believe me, I have been looking for money for this.
Yeah.
We tried. We put in for several grants to get spraying equipment with Hatfield. We go to Ed Lesko and I go to all these things, and we talk about mutual working together and hitting up money. But there's just the bottom line is it's getting really bad, and we've got to do something. And people expected us to do more than we have been doing. And we're getting complaints, and I understand. I totally understand. But we have to actually do something. And this spraying is not pesticide spraying, this insecticide. This is the neutering of the male mosquitoes so that you actually are affecting the breeding cycle. And that's why it's
spraying so... very small scissors.
This is why it's so important that we all work together, because you're hopefully will neuter all the mosquitoes up and down the valley here.
Status with mosquitoes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Magnifying glass. Please,
okay. Can we go on to the next budget item?
Yes. All
right. It's a new expense, but it's... Yeah. This is the problem with climate change. There are consequences of our climate change.
Yes.
And we have mosquitoes now all the time. Right, okay. Up through Christmas.
Okay. Want to keep going?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just pointing out the senior center budget. I've worked with Marlene Johnson on that. Because of the negotiations with the new director and because of a few other additional expenses, that budget went from $55,000 to $65,000 this year, with Deerfield's portion being showing an increase of $5,000. So we've gone from $27,000 to $32,000 for the senior center. It's not a whole lot of money, but it's 16% or so, 17%. So I just thought I'd point that out. Let's see. Just want to make sure I'm not doing anything else wrong. I think you two have the updated Veterans District assessment. I had estimated it at $8,200. It's actually just over $8,000. That we just got confirmation of that this week. Veterans Benefits is flat funded at 35. Of course, we get state money for that.
Is that coming in any faster, Doug?
The Veterans money? I do not know how fast it's coming in at all.
Okay. That was pretty slow. Yeah.
But it is coming in.
Okay.
So it's a money in, money out kind of thing. The Tilton Library budget shows an increase of about $13,000. This isn't a result of increases in the current staff's salary, but it is an addition of a new staff person at about $5,800, and increases in a few of the line items for operating the library. This is, again, something I think that the board should just be aware of, that there's another position being added there. And it's going to cost us about another $8,000 or $9,000. About $6,000. I believe it's related to increases in hours. They want to increase the hours of the library, so they want to they need to increase some of the smaller dollar staff to allow that to happen.
Again, I just would like us to have something that if somebody asks us a question, why?
Sure.
We have a good reason for why it is.
Okay.
It's a simple narrative. I don't think it's that tough for. I've been on the committee for the Tilton Library. I've been voted in as a member of the directors. I think that if we don't have one, then we need to get one. I'll get one.
Okay.
If we don't, then.
There may be one there. I may just not have included it with this budget.
Right.
So give me a day or two to go back and look, and I will get one for you. If it exists.
If I can go get it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I'll bring it to you.
Yep, sounds good to me. But please don't assume I don't have one because they didn't want to provide one. I'm not sure yet.
It's not a tough question. I mean, there's no criticism with this. It's just something that... I'm trying to get us in the habit of getting this stuff so that somebody asks us a question without looking like you're in the headlights.
Yep, sounds good to me. Okay, I'm just making a note of that. Let's see. I am now going to commit political suicide. Right here on camera. There's two programs that I want the board to seriously consider whether they want to continue. The summer swim program and the Tri-Town Beach program. My concern is that, and I'm going to take a cue from the headlines perhaps, that this is a program where Deerfield pays about 70% of the overall, let me make sure I've got that percentage correct. Deerfield pays about 78% of the overall budget for these programs, at least for the Tri-Town Beach. And we have had a very hard time keeping representatives on that board. Further, the budgets have, for at least the past year, if not longer, been for a full year's worth of operational expenses. And yet the beach was closed last year, for example, for a good third of the time. About 5 weeks out over the course of the summer where the beach was closed due to health reasons. At the very least, I think there should be a request for accounting for the Tri-Town Beach But in terms of looking at the broader budget and looking at areas where there could be reductions in expenses with the least impact on the residents of Deerfield, this is one area where there could be some focus. I'm putting it to you for your consideration.
Maybe can we find out how many kids it services?
I can I can officially request statistics on how many visitors were there, where they were coming from, what kind of fees were paid, because people who go to use the beach, there's still an annual fee. Even if you're a resident of Deerfield or Waitley, there's still an annual fee for...
And where do the fees go?
That's something else I can request.
Yeah.
Yep. So
I think you should also ask for what are the plans? With that much problem last year staying open, is there... I don't know why, and is it something that's likes to be recurring, is likely to be recurring?
Yes, the answer is yes. What we have down there is essentially a spring-fed pond. It's fed from a spring that comes underground. And the reason it was closed the most of the time was due to bacteria count in the water. And because there's no water moving through there, because it's essentially a static body of water, short of chemically treating the pond, to keep bacteria count down, the problem will recur.
Well, it's recurred over the years. I'm familiar with the history of Triton Beach. But
okay.
If it's reoccurred many times in the past, say, 5 years or 10 years or whatever, and it's out of track, there are other things like they can make the water move through, they can aerate the water, they can do other things.
Sure.
I'm not totally up to date on. There were things that were proposed over the past years, but discounted because they didn't think it was bad enough to have to do it.
Sure.
They should be giving us an accounting as to what they think they're going to do to minimize the damage.
Sure.
And you know, what's the game plan?
Okay.
That's going to be really hard because most of the, as you said, most of the people from Deerfield haven't been there for very long. And the people that we will have the accounting from won't even know how to ask for it. So
okay,
we'll have to do some chasing on that.
Okay,
okay.
I will do some research on that. Recreation Department is as expected, moving right along. Historical Commission is flat level funded. Veterans Day Memorial expense, that was an increase from $1,700. $1,750 to $2,000. That was my adjustment upward. I believe there may have been some mention of it way back when, several months ago, but I increased it from $1,750 to $2,000. They've been at $1,750 for about the past 3 or 4 years, and it was such a minor increase, I didn't think it was that big of an issue.
You've done a great job.
I can talk with John Siz to find out if he needs all of that money. But they have in the past spent that much, so
yes,
there's that.
And they made the town look good. It's been a good event.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it's one of those things that it doesn't hurt to ask.
Absolutely. Right. The next items coming up are maturing debt. And the one item in here that we do need to talk about, we've talked about it a little bit, is the energy loan. We've received notice from the town clerk. She's asked... that we either pay off the energy loan completely through cash, use of free cash, or that we bond out for it. Apparently, she's been able to pay back the loan thus far using short-term borrowing, but we need to either take out a longer-term bond for it, or we need to pay it off completely. I admit I am not entirely versed on this subject. There's a lot of research I've got to do by digging into the files. There's some information I think I can get through the DOER, and I'm going to need to reach out to past and present members of the
energy that we didn't use.
Okay.
Our bills, our electric bills, and all of our other things should have either been diminished by quantity used, and that amount of money should have gone back to pay back this loan.
Okay.
But we've still been taking credit for all the money that's been spent electrically, and the biggest savings was at the elementary school. It should have come out of the savings. In other words, the budget should have been the same, and money should have been moved from the school budget for electricity into paying that loan off, because it's artificially not being charged to the school and for the facilities in which we put this stuff into.
Okay.
So basically, the budget still took credit for all the savings, and we're paying this loan off on the side and not having a balance sheet that shows that basically savings in the school budget collectively should have been shifted over to pay this loan off.
Okay.
We should be making money.
Okay, so it's your contention that even if we go back through and look at the records and do additional reporting or talk to various people, that this is still a loan that we have to pay off. There's no way to get around that?
We still have to pay it off. We can do it any way we want to. I mean, we can take and bond it and get rid of it because short-term loans are costing us too much money.
Sure.
But being realistic, being a true thing, we did all this energy saving stuff so we saved a ton of money. And if we're just still paying the same amount for electricity and not saving any money and having people accountable for what their budgets are, which is for this particular item is the school, again, all of that $55,000 a year that we saved by doing this thing should have come off the school budget and saved the townspeople money. And we should have been telling the townspeople that basically the school's budget is artificially lowered or is lowered because of these credits, the stuff we did.
Okay.
And we're not. We just keep letting the bills and the budgets reflect not the savings. We didn't do the thing we were supposed to do, which was say, hey, we did this great job, cost us $250,000, we're saving ourselves $55,000 or whatever a year in electricity. That savings, that money should have been captured as a line item to pay back the loan, not go to short-term borrowing. So what we've done is we've created that thing that scares the hell out of me, is this artificial thought that the school budget is only going up by 5.2%, when in reality it's going up by this amount because they have to pay for... They're taking money that we actually saved them and still spending it.
Sure.
Does that make sense?
Totally get it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So this is the problem here is we've saved the money. We've done a great job. We've saved the townspeople money, but the people who are getting credit for it aren't the people who did the work. The people who are getting the credit are the people who are taking advantage of the extra money and spending it anyways.
Sure. Got it. Okay.
Mark, one question. The dollar amount, it's Jeff asking question. The dollar amount, I think, is around $260. Off the top of your head, do you think that's a fairly accurate number?
Yes.
Okay.
The original loan was for something like $350,000?
Yeah, $386 or $3 something. Yeah.
Something like that? Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Okay, thank you. That's a big help to the finance
committee. If we look at the report that we did last year or 2 years ago, you can see that we actually saved a lot of money in BTUs and a lot of money in electricity. But we didn't actually show that.
Right. No, I understand.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Mark.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
So is the recommendation that we just bond for it and just pay it off?
I got to look into that. I said something that I may not be correct on. It may be that we have to pay for this out of savings and we're not doing it, because we're bonding to pay it off. So it may be something that we need to, for accounting purposes, show that it's a savings to the town.
Okay.
But I think we can. I think we can just go ahead and bond and not take the short-term penalties.
Okay. What I will do is confirm that information with Jane Pfister at the DOER next week.
Yep.
And we'll see what she says. Maybe she's got some rabbits she can pull out of a hat, and maybe we can save a little money. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, what I'll ask is for town clerk to give us an estimate for a borrowing on that, and then to include it on the maturing debt budgets that she submitted
this
far.
And we also, with the insurances, show that basically we saved the schools and the town office and this amount of money, in which we kept paying. and it's, you know, the energy savings are there and real and tangible, but we're not showing any credit for it.
The budget wasn't reduced as a result. Yeah. Okay.
Do we also want to do a comparison as far as paying it out of free cash? And just to take a look and see if we did that, how that impact this year's budget or the 17 budget?
I would have no problem with that. I think that it was a good idea, but I don't think we're going to have anywhere near the money to actually do free cash,
right,
have any money left in free cash, have any money left in for stabilization for capital, which is killing us. We got to do something with that. So from my point, if we could pay just the amount of the loan from free cash, which is, I think, around $50,000, and not go on to the tax rate, that probably would be more respectable for just so that we keep it separated out in some way, so that we could start taking and showing that we've done some initiatives that save the town's people money. So I don't think they'd pay it off all in one whack, but you could actually look at paying it in two chunks or two and a half chunks or something like that to
right.
make it more.
Okay.
So keep some money in free cash and some money in stabilization for capital.
Right, correct. That makes sense. And I'm sure information that Doug
just have.
Do you have any questions?
It's insurances, it's Medicare, it's retirement. And those are numbers which are basically spoon-fed to the town. There's really not a whole lot we can do with those numbers. There's not a lot to discuss. Short of laying off people and not having to pay for their insurance or their retirement, there's not really much we can do there.
Right. All we can do in that area is start looking at reality, how we want to run the next 5 years of government and start driving towards it.
Right.
Even if we laid off people, we're still going to pay unemployment taxes and everything else, and basically right. the amount of money we save is going to not be a tangible.
I was just going to say, people don't realize you don't really save money.
Right.
So, hey, do you guys need me for anything else?
We have just some other bits of information, but what I can do is put that into a report, and I'll send it to you via email, or I'll catch up with you at the beginning of next week.
Actually, Mark, can you just stay on for a couple more minutes while we talk about the roof? Because we have to... Right?
Yep.
The school roof?
Did you get sorted out on that?
I did get sorted out. The bottom line on the school roof project is as follows. The finance committee has appropriated $3,850, I think, is the amount. That is the amount that will allow Pink & Company and RDA to continue the work through March 11. The finance committee was asked to appropriate $15,500, but they only chose to appropriate that amount because they're expecting that the debt exclusion vote will pass and then the full appropriation will go into effect. We've been asked by the school department to put together a letter that basically confirms that appropriation by the finance committee and requests that Pink & Company and RDA continue working at least till March 11. So I actually put that together. I put together a letter which says exactly that. It'll be copied to all the relevant parties and sent off if you guys approve. I'm also giving David and Carolyn a copy of a budget. This is basically a refinement of a spreadsheet that Patty Kavanaugh put together. It kind of explains the where we're at money-wise and what the story is. Bottom line, the money has been appropriated. We need to just tell Pink & Company to keep going until March 11.
I have no problem with that.
Okay.
Yeah.
The only other thing that I want to make the board aware of is that Dick Kalaszewski has been looking seriously at the construction documents as presented to him. He has some serious questions about the snow load, about the overall load on the roof, and whether or not the extra weight from the extra materials is going to exceed the legal capacity of that roof. He's consulted with an engineer. I don't yet have his final word, but suffice it to say that he has grave concerns as to whether or not this project as designed can go forward, whether or not he can actually issue a building permit for it. He's expected to be able to conclude that information and provide the board with a recommendation next week. So hopefully we'll have some answers next week.
As of today.
Let me rephrase this a little bit.
Okay.
We have an engineer and an architect that's doing all the calculations, and they're highly ranked in their by the state of Massachusetts rules and regulations. And we at the level of Board of Selectmen feel that that there is actually a major issue with the calculations of the work they're doing for us.
From my point of view,
if that's the case,
right,
then we probably shouldn't give them any money.
How
can we have confidence in something that is engineeringly designed, and we feel that the engineering capability of the people are suspect, that they can't do the job?
There could be an issue. We need to confirm that. That's what Dick is working on.
They have not responded to Dick all week.
RDA hasn't?
Dick ran the calculations and sent them the calculations and said he had questions. And would they respond? And they have not responded. As of today.
Okay.
Remember we had last year, Mark, the problems with snow load? Dick had that argument with, I don't know, whoever. And so they had an engineer come out, and they agreed that Dick's calculations were correct, that the roof snow, the snow had to be removed from the roof because the snow load was too much. And so Dick used the same loading numbers that the engineer developed for the snow load information, ran the calculations, and sent them to Pink and Company, I guess, whoever it was, and said that, or whether it was RDA, I'm not sure who.
RDA,
okay. And said that these are the numbers that he used, and according to his numbers, it exceeds the building code.
The rated load for the structure.
And so would they please respond that their design, in fact, does address this, and they have not responded.
Okay.
So it makes me a little concerned.
I'm very concerned. The point I'm trying to make is we have a very highly reputable engineering firm, and we now have an engineering firm that says that what they're doing is inappropriate or is not correct or not designed. And we're finding it out where we have somebody who has thousands of people on payroll to make sure that what they're doing is correct, and they're not correct.
Well, Mark, I reviewed the Dick's review of the specs, and every other page practically had a sticky on it. So I have to say that the red flags have been raised on this.
I would recommend until we get confirmation that the building commissioner's numbers are accurate.
We need to get somebody to do that because right. The reality of it
He's
is
working on that.
I feel like they are car salesmen that told us they couldn't do the job this year if we didn't appropriate money, which then they turned out and said, oh, that's not really true, we can do it anyways. Then I feel like I got a snake oil salesman. If Dick is right and they're wrong, I think we should just scrap the project and have them fix the roof, and we'll work on it next year and try to get somebody who's reputable. I think we've got snake oil salesmen who are going to push this thing down our throats, and we're going to, just like Sutherland did with a roof that's non-compliant and dangerous to the kids in it.
Okay.
Mark, I agree.
Yeah. So my recommendation is actually to make sure to let Dick confirm with another engineer, with an independent engineer, confirm his calculations or correct his calculations. And until we get that information, I would strongly advise against going too crazy off the handle. But if Dick is confirmed, if the calculations are confirmed, then the board can choose to do something else at that point.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, Mark, the only reason I wanted you on the phone was because I wanted you to know that I was concerned and that, you know, we're supposed to make this decision and approve the contract and all that kind of stuff. And, I, you know, I'm not, I'm leery.
Okay.
Well, Dick's concerned enough to run the flagpole, but the reality of it is we're authorizing money to an organization that can't do their job.
I know.
And yeah. I think that that would be basically a sin.
Yeah. Well, we can.
In reality, if he's correct and they didn't do it, then I really want to know why the hell they're on the approved visitors list.
Well, and that's why I told Dick he's got to certainly document it so we can send it to DCAMP and say, you know what, people should not be on your list.
Yeah.
Because they were assigned to
us. Absolutely.
They were assigned
to us. They're just as bad as the people that did the construction work at Old Deerfield sewer treatment. The DCAMP report should be that they didn't do their job correctly. Even if it meets the spec, or meets the output that it is, they used up a lot more space. They didn't give us any change order notices. They didn't do anything with us. And the first thing we got was that they spent twice as much money as they had projected.
Right.
How can an engineering firm, and I'm not talking about Martin, because Martin didn't do the engineering. The engineering was done by the other company. Martin did the install. We sent it to another engineering firm who designed something that was not what Martin agreed to.
I know. I agree.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we just won't make any more expenditures to them until we get Dick's report.
At least get a response. I think it's gross that they did not respond to him.
Okay. So, in other words, you do not want Pink or RDA to move forward with the project until we get a response on this? Or do you want me to just not do anything until we get Dick's information?
Dick's information. The thing about it is we have to send a letter out, but Dick needs to get the response as quickly as possible.
Okay.
Yep.
Because I really don't want to pay these people another dime if they can't do their job.
Fair enough.
Yep. I agree.
Okay. Then we'll put a hold on that letter until maybe next week. And we'll see where it goes from there.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, Dick should be able to get something from his engineering firm fairly quickly. If the calculations are already done, it's just re-crunching the numbers.
Right, to make sure he's accurate. Okay. All right, then that's it.
Very good.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate you putting up with me.
Mark, okay. I will be sending you some more information, because the rest of what I've got is pretty much just announcements, so I'll make sure you've got all that coming to you. And it'll be waiting for you when you get home.
Thank you very much.
All right, thanks.
Have a good day.
Bye, Mark. Be safe.
Bye-bye.
Okay. And Mark left the meeting at 5:05. Okay. Mark. I can go really, really quickly and summarize everything else very, very fast if you folks want to just listen. Some good news, some mixed news. The Collins Center for Municipal or for Public Management at UMass Boston is on the job when it comes to doing the assessment of salaries, the salary survey. I don't expect to get answers for the next 3 to 4 weeks from them, because a lot of what they're going to do relies on feedback from all of our neighboring towns. But at least it's on board. That, again, that's $4,500. It's a lot less than we had budgeted for or that we had appropriated, so there's that.
Yep.
We are accepted. Our community compact has been accepted, and there will be a signing ceremony next Friday, the 11th, down in Northampton. We're going to be joining other towns and cities as part of the signing ceremony down there. And even before we signed, we had the opportunity to apply for some grant money. I completed a request for $45,000 for the IT grant program. This is money that would allow us to upgrade our computer infrastructure in all of Town Hall, set up some off-site backups at the Senior Center, and actually improve the internet connectivity for both facilities. It does require some local funding, but yeah. I think that that can happen without too much difficulty. I'm hoping to hear back from them. It'll be good. Yeah, it'll be great if it can come into fruition.
Yeah.
So I wanted to let you know about that. We did receive a response from Senator Ed Markey in regard to our concerns about the pipeline and the process as it's existed at the federal level. You have a copy of that in your packet if you need to review it. Yep. Let me go through the rest of the good news, then we'll hit the bad news. Our solar system at the Old Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Plant is fully online and operational. We received full authority to switch it over, and we're doing that. We've already completed our first quarterly report, and we'll continue to do that to maintain that authority. So that's good news. You can take a look and see what they're doing. I will also be, speaking of solar, I'll be speaking with Beth Greenblatt at the beginning of the next week, basically charging her to get going on developing an RFP for solar on the landfill.
Yep.
We need to run at that full speed.
Yes.
And I'm going to ask her to do so.
Yeah. Can't keep on dragging our feet on that one.
Yep. The Board of Selectmen has received a resignation from Alan Lipp, who will be stepping down from the Frontier Regional School Committee. I'm not sure. Is he an appointment?
That's elected, isn't it?
Is that elected?
Frontier School Committee.
Frontier Regional School? Okay. So he's just providing notice that he's going to be stepping down, and that'll be a position that'll be open and on the ballot.
Effective.
He just is saying that I will not stand up for re-election.
Okay.
So he'll serve out the end of his term.
Yep.
There's that. I'll address that a little bit later. We received a letter of feedback, and I don't know if you received this already, but I'll let you have a copy of it. This is from Ralph Healy. It's a response in regard to what happened at town meeting on the 25th. Yeah. It's a pretty extensive letter. There's a copy of it. I just want to make sure you're aware that it exists.
Okay.
To the not-so-good news, this is something, of course, we've talked about. Oh, I'm sorry. No, well, I'll address this request. This came in today. This is from Deerfield Police Department. Chief Pachorik is requesting an appointment of a part-time police officer, effective right away. And I think I gave you a copy of that letter.
Yeah.
This would be to replace someone who is going to be stepping down.
Okay.
And he would love to have your action on that, or you can defer to next week. It's up to you.
Want to make a vote on that for appointing Officer Eugen?
I make a motion that we appoint him as recommended by the chief.
I'll second it. Any further discussion?
Nope.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Okay. And the other thing we got from the chief. Maybe not the best of news. This is what's coming up.
You know what? This is fine. Just scan it and forward it to Christopher. Okay.
It has already been forwarded to him.
Okay.
Lisa Mead is also going to be putting together a full and complete opinion on this.
Okay.
I was at the police department, and the recommendation right now is not to make any arrests until we get an official from Lisa, because if we do have to go to court, Lisa's the one's going to go.
Yep.
Not Christopher.
Oh, I know.
Yep.
I know. But, again, it's our Board of Health, cease and desist order until it's turned over in court.
Yeah.
Has precedence over DPU. And
it does?
Yes.
Okay.
It is. It does. And so, I'm glad that the police, chief's organization is waiting, but the fact is that they didn't even look into all the case history for Board of Health, and so maybe whether Christopher wants to fill him in or not, I don't know. I'll call him and ask him, but the thing is, this is, you have to educate him all over again. It's just, it's so ridiculous.
Sure.
Yeah, it's just
it's so labor intensive.
Yep.
I just wish it would go away.
Just a couple other very small notes I have posted for a part-time position for the office. This has been listed as a temporary position with a term to end June 30th, but with the option to extend if the money exists or the need exists. I will be asking for some assistance from other department heads in town to help in the interviews, but I want to start interviewing, I believe, after the 15th, as quickly as possible, and hire somebody and get somebody in there right away.
Okay.
It's starting to feel like I'm kind of swimming against the tide when it comes to the paperwork, and I'd really love to have somebody else there to help.
But I'm seriously worried. You cannot burn yourself out.
Don't worry. I've got fire extinguishers at the ready, so
did
I think
you,
it'll be good.
Did you call Wendy and see what her schedule is?
I have not touched base with Wendy yet. I have been touching base with Casey quite a bit, though, and getting a lot of great information from her.
Okay.
And she's been really an excellent resource.
All right. Well, I mean, Dave, if it's all right with you, can Doug just call Wendy and see if there's any hours that Wendy can work?
Yeah, sure.
Because Wendy, sure. Number one, she's just very efficient and so pleasant to work with. And
mm-hmm.
She'd be such a good person to mm-hmm. be a reference.
As long as she understands that she'd be working under...
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's not her personality. She's so easy. Though.
I know. I just, you know, she was the interim town administrator before, and I just don't want to be...
No, sure. No, this is not, Doug, you are in charge. It's
okay.
Just that she's so experienced. She has mm-hmm. so much experience. She can help you with trying to sort some of this stuff out and organize stuff, and you don't have to train her. You can just give her
sure.
something,
okay.
and she'll be able to do it.
Okay, yeah, no, absolutely.
But also, as a reference for you... If you know, so how about this? You know,
yeah.
A 5-minute conversation with her would save you hours maybe of work.
Sure.
And so what you should do is, you know, if she can come in,
mm-hmm.
is just have a pile of stuff that you could sit down with her and go
okay.
over.
Okay. As consulting kind
yeah,
of thing. Okay.
Absolutely.
Fair enough.
She did wonderful work with Casey.
Okay.
And it saved Casey hours and hours of research.
Okay.
And you know, that's anything that would help you be more efficient,
okay,
and would help you along the learning curve would be wonderful.
All right, fair enough. The only other thing I've got is, can you sign my payroll sheet? And that's it for now.
Okay.
One more thing.
Oh gosh, you're right. I apologize. Let me find it. That's not it. That's Ed Markey. That's Alan Lipp. There it is. I have received... He already knows about this. I have officially received a letter of resignation from David Wolfram. It is with deep regret that I submit my letter of resignation from the Town of Deerfield Board of Selectmen and the Board of Oversight for the South County EMS, both effective May 1st, 2016. It has been an honor and a privilege to serve my town in both of these capacities, and it is my sincere wish that if circumstances change, I am able to serve the town of Deerfield in the future. So I think
bored you.
I think, I mean, are you going to come back every like couple weeks?
Every 3 weeks. Yeah.
Well, we could have a meeting every Friday.
Yeah.
If you wanted.
Yeah, I'm going to try to coordinate it to, you know, so the best I can. I'll fly back on Thursdays and fly here on Thursdays and fly back to Kentucky on Sunday. So that's the plan.
So every third Friday you'd be in town or something?
Yeah.
Okay.
God, what a drag.
Hmm?
What a drag.
Hmm.
Well, I guess I'll have to accept it.
That way,
I don't think you can reject it.
Well, it's just Barb needs it because nomination
yes.
papers for the
yes.
ballot have to be
correct.
Done by the 26th of
yes.
this
February,
month. So,
right.
Yes. I don't...
And
no.
and
I don't.
While she has posted the open positions on the wall of the town hall, she has been waiting
yeah.
until you
yeah.
were able to make that
yeah.
public notification before she publishes anything.
Yeah.
So I'll make sure she gets a copy of this right away. And she'll be able to take care of that first thing next week.
Okay. Any other business for the board?
Anything else is just purely communication, and I can do that via email and
okay.
as it comes in.
Do I hear a motion?
I can make that motion.
I'll second it. Committee.